Okay, I'm LaDonna Cunsolo, and I'm interviewing Pastor Sarah Owusu. She's at Agape House Church in Accra, Ghana. All right, Pastor Sarah, what is your favorite creative presentation?
I have a few that I like using. One is I really like drawing the Bible story that I'm telling the kids. I'm not a good artist, but that is what actually makes the method so fun. So, for example, if I'm telling the story of Jonah, I'll draw little stick figures for different parts of the story where he's running away from God, where he's on the ship, being thrown overboard. And sometimes I'll draw them as I tell the kids about them. And then as I'm talking about that scene, I'm drawing it, and then I show them the little stick figure drawing I've done. And that always seems to engage them. It's funny, but at the same time, tracking what I'm saying because they're seeing little pictures of the story. So that's one creative method I really like. Another one is having the kids act out what I'm telling them, and that can be a Bible story, or even if I'm just talking about a and I have a presentation based on something that happened today, calling kids act it out, even if they're dramatic, using my drama to get the kid to be dramatic or to get the audience to participate. It can be really funny if you have a kid who's not dramatic at all and you tell them to cry, and you know, they give like a little cry and then the audience laughs. So that's another method I like. And third one would probably be dressing as a Bible character and telling a story from the first person. It always gets the kid's attention, and it all makes the Bible story much more personal, because instead of telling the kids this is what happened to someone else, you're acting as if you're that person and telling them what happened to you personally, and it makes it a lot more real to them. So those are some of my favorite creative methods.
That sounds really fun. I hadn't thought about the drawing one in real time. That's good. So what are some of the challenges of creating and facilitating creative delivery of biblical content?
One challenge, I think, is making sure you don't lose the message and the excitement. If you're sitting down to think of what can engage kids and what can excite kids, it can sometimes be a temptation to go overboard in terms of just getting the kids excited or just getting them to have fun. Sometimes even when maybe you're doing an object lesson or you're telling a story, if there's one particular part of the story that's really getting the kids to laugh, it can be a temptation for me as a teacher to emphasize that and more making sure the kids are having fun listening to me. And sometimes then tapping out to get to the main point or to really drive it home. Or I might end up spending more time just having fun with them than give them an application for the lesson. So I think making sure you don't lose the message and the excitement, and also when you're planning creative methods, making sure that you're thinking of the message first and letting the creativity come from the message, because sometimes you can think of your do and you're trying to fit in, and that times a challenge for me at many responses. If you want to be, the more it engage, which is it want them to engage, you don't want to talking, but the more the responses you can have from them. You all be for not draw from it, and they might draw a totally different conclusion from it. They might not get the way you were leading them. So I think being prepared to manage their responses, manage if they get too excited, manage if they lose focus, they get off track, or maybe at the end of all the presentation that you've done, they just they're still focusing on like the magic trick you did or the gospel illusion that you did, and so knowing how to handle those situations.
So it's probably a lot of in the moment decisions, kind of reading the room and seeing where everybody is at. Yeah.
Yes, and every group of kids differently to the same thing. I mean, we have 4 services every weekend, and there are some services that laugh hysterically at maybe a video we show or a story we tell, and you tell it in another service and they're looking at you like, why are we doing this? So knowing how to manage those responses, but most of all, if you know the message to communicate, then knowing how to turn even an unexpected message.
That's great. And what do you think are some of the rewards of creating your own lessons and units instead of using like a pre-bought one?
Question. It's definitely a lot more work. I find because I write and I teach, I'm able to engage more. Saying someone else's curriculum, it's not always easy to follow their train of thought, especially if they've got their own, you know, they didn't clearly communicate in writing, they were thinking when they put everything down, so thought curriculum, it's hard to see how to connect. But I think writing it yourself, you really understand why you're doing every segment of the service, and everything, where you've did every scripture. So I think it's as a teacher to get familiar with the content and for it to be something that God has inside of you. So that I also think with ministry in particular, because West in the U.S. or in UK, it includes ideas that are not suited to our facility or to the materials that we have readily available to us. So sometimes you can look at a curriculum that you've bought online, and you know that our space is very limited. So you know that you can't play that game or you can't do that illustration in the space we have. So being able to customize what we're doing to work within the number of kids we have, the number of volunteers we have, the space that we have in our helpful. And I also gives the, and then myself as a children's pastor, a say in what we're addressing. So it gives us the opportunity when we're developing our own curriculum to have conversations with us, find out where they're at, use our lesson singing.
Sorry, I missed that last bit. What did you said you have conversations with them? Yeah.
Yeah, having conversations with the kids and finding out what's really going on in their life, and then being able to write lessons address those specific issues. So if there's, you know, if all the peer pressure, that's a topic that's come up recently. It's not like we're teaching them every week on, you know, giving, which is a great thing for the kids to learn about, but they also need to learn how to walk out their faith in their daily lives. So that's been helpful. You know, just having the flexibility to address what's actually going on in the kids' lives.
And then my last question is just, how do you decide what type of maybe like pop culture things that you're going to incorporate or ignore? Because sometimes there are things that are really trendy, but do you have like a criteria whether or not you would use it, or what makes that determination, you know, whether you're going to acknowledge it in children's church or not?
That's a really good question. The standard that we've set so far is we don't use like, let's say, Disney-related things or the superhero movies, the Marvel Universe and all those things. Those are things that are very popular with kids, things like Fortnite, Minecraft. We don't include them in our ministry in anything that you would see visually or that you would come across playing music from those shows or dance moves from those like characters. We don't incorporate that. What I encourage my teachers is to be aware of what the kids are watching, to be aware of what they're into, and to engage with the kids on a relational level. You know, if a new movie comes out and they ask them, have you seen that movie? What was it about? And then maybe as the kids talk about it, tell them, well, you know, what that person actually did was tell a lie. What do you think about that? You know, and that leads us into a lot of conversations. So that's the extent to which we would bring those things into our ministry time. But I don't think it's worth it. I think that if you look at most of these things that the kids are into, especially in terms of media and in terms of characters, you can always draw illustrations out of them that might teach a biblical truth, but fundamentally, there's so many other issues with that kind of stuff. So we don't bring it into a church environment, and we've never missed it, or we've never felt like we were not engaging kids because we didn't use it. We found so many other ways to create our own characters that the kids love, and you know, just kind of create our own world of ministry things. And we found that that has been successful in engaging the kids.
And what do you do if you get a volunteer that is not really a kid person? You know, some people want to be kid people, but they just don't connect. Do you work with them, or do you just kind of leave them as is? What would you do?
We let them, first of all, when a volunteer comes in, we have about a month before we give them any definite role for them just to observe. If we see that they're really not into the maybe interaction or relationship side, we might talk to them about joining like ICAM, where they're behind the computer, printing up things. Of course, they start to engage with kids, but it's not necessarily like they're teaching them. So that's an option for someone who wants to serve, but they're not necessarily excited about leading a small group or being with two-year-olds or something like that. For other people, once they've had a month to observe, we give them feedback. If we see that they're really not able to engage with the kids, then talking to them about, okay, asking the kids these questions. Find with most adults, even when they come, if they're not kid people, they're around other adults who are doing things in a particular way, mostly they're going to start imitating the other adults around them. So I think we have a pretty healthy culture of engagement and relationships between the volunteers and the kids. And so almost anytime someone comes in, they just pick it up because it's something that's emphasized.
Okay. Okay, well, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.